made Contemporary the label that you really wanted to pursue?
Well, I didn't necessarily pursue it. I was the kid that hung out at the hi-fi shop on Saturday. My first love was motion pictures and the whole way that it's done. I was more interested in the process. And so I was really kind of into motion picture stuff, projectors and stuff. And like when I was 12 years old, I had a projector that I had bought and I would tear it apart and put it all back together. And wow. I was like fanatic about all this stuff. And then I got a job at a film library. I could take all these movies home if I wanted to. They were 16 millimeter, but you know, and I owned my own projector and all this stuff. But here I am, I think 14 years old, and I'm going back and forth from this film library, especially in the summertime. I was going every day. But there was this shop that I would go by every day that said High Fidelity Sound Systems. But the way it used to be is, you know, it was all hobby stuff. You know, it was like you'd look inside there and all the speakers would be on the shelves. You'd see university speakers and all the Altech speakers, you know, but they'd show the speaker would be sitting on the, and then they'd have cabinets you could build, or they had ready-built ones. They had that. And then they had amplifiers sitting there. I go into the shop and I'm looking around and drooling. I'm looking at these MC30 amplifiers. Wow. And so the first nice. Macintoshes were out then. So, and this was early 50s. So it's only high fidelity, no stereo, nothing. And so I'm looking at all this stuff, and he says, let me play you something. I says, okay, you know. So he played this record, and that was it. I just couldn't believe it. I absolutely could not believe it, how great it sounded to me. And from that day on, forget about movies. It was all audio equipment, all records. And the records that he had in the shop to sell to audiophiles, because he wasn't a record store, were Contemporary. So when I would buy one of those, it was like, you could tell. There was a reason why he did that, because they were the best sounding. I drive over, and here I don't know what to do. I've got a suit on with a tie, and I walk into his place. And I said, well, I wanted to meet you because, you know, Roy DuNann told me about you and this and that. And he says, Roy was telling me about you. Yeah, that's great. He says, Contemporary Lester over there doesn't have an engineer. Why don't you take the job over there? And I says, I don't know anything yet. I mean, I've just been hanging out in the studio and winding cables and you know, just trying to understand what everybody's doing. And he said the key word. He said, look, he says, if you love your work, you'll figure out a way. And here he was in a t-shirt, soup pan, eating his lunch out of a soup pan. That's Howard Holzer. He's like a bull in a china shop in a way. Yeah. It was working on me, what Howard said. So after about a month, I thought, you know, I could figure out how to do all this stuff. I mean, I was so passionate about it anyway. I knew I would be able to do it if I just get around it. So I called up Howard. I said, Howard, do you really think you could get an interview with me with Lester? Because I'm getting out of school, you know, summer school in August, and I could come over there. And he says, I'll set it up for you. So I'm going to school, and I'm taking my final exams. I mean, getting ready for final exams. And it's like I hadn't talked to him for months. Right, so I thought, well, I better call Howard and see if he's really done this. So I called him out. It was about 2 weeks before I got out. So I called Howard and I says, Howard, did you get that interview? Because I'd been studying how to cut discs and I'd been working with Roy and I've been getting myself all primed. So I called up Howard and I says, did you get me that interview with Lester? He says, oh, he got you the job. He says, when can you start? So I got in my car and I went right over there as soon as I got out of summer school. And I walked in. Howard takes me over there. And we walk in to Contemporary. And Lester's in the cutting room. I walk in and Lester says, oh, Howard says, you're terrific. He says, I don't need to know anything else. When can you start?
These people, Howard and Lester Koenig and Roy, you had knew them before. You knew their names before you actually met them.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Been looking at all those albums.
But how surprised were you to know, like, how...
Well, I never thought I'd ever be the engineer at Contemporary or work there. I mean, because to me, it was on a pedestal. It was like, oh, my... I mean, Hollywood. Oh.
Right, that's what I mean. Like, these names are famous. How did you know they'd be so accessible? I mean, did you... You never...
Well, I was also really, really headstrong. I mean, I was very ambitious. I mean, I was like... I was just one of those people that I was going to be there whether you liked it or not. Well, I could be quiet. I wasn't necessarily obnoxious, I don't think. But I was so enthusiastic about it and I was so passionate about it that I was, they could see it in my eyes. And that's why they helped me.
That's what
they saw more in me than I did.
Passion and enthusiasm and attitude is really everything.
Well, it is, and I just had it. Yeah. I mean, I didn't think about it. I didn't plan it. It was just so open. If I looked at an image and I was walking around town or something and it looked like an arm or a turntable, I would see a turntable. It was that bad.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I would see it in everything.
I think if young people that were at that point in their lives tried and believed that they could get to one of the main people of whatever they're interested in, and they try, they can. And I think that, like, all of you guys helped me when I didn't, I mean, not that I know much now, but if a master at a craft, they'll reach down and put a hand out and they'll help people. If they really believe this person
cares.
They will help.
Oh, yeah.
And I don't really think that people realize...
That they are accessible.
That these people are real people and they're accessible and they will help. And, I think these masters at their craft will help because people help them and they passing it down, especially a lot of this stuff with the cutter heads and lacquers, and analog tape.
I never dreamed, sitting in my bedroom in Phoenix, Arizona, that I would ever one day actually be here, or even in the, I never planned even on any of this. I never really had those ambitions necessarily. It's just that it was in front of me, and I thought, oh, it's an opportunity. I'll take it. But I was never headstrong to the point where I was reckless. You know, all of this stuff that I've done all through my life has all been when it was really a secure thing to make the next move. Like when I moved from Contemporary to A&M, or when I moved from A&M into my own business. You know, I made sure the first console that was built took 3 years to build, and it was built by the head of maintenance at A&M in his garage on weekends, because I was so insecure. There was enough insecurity there that I knew was it wasn't all about me. It also was about my tools. I knew that was a big part of it. And so I got him involved in being part of the company.
What's his name?
Carl Bischoff.
The person, the maintenance guy at A&M?
Yeah, he was head of maintenance at A&M. And a friend, too. You know, we worked together for a long time. And I saw in him a person that I really could work with. And he knew all the systems at A&M, of course. And so I made him a proposition to be part of a mastering studio, have a percentage of the company. And so he proceeded, whenever he had any time, to build this console in his garage, the first console, because I knew that I had to have the right tools around me, and I didn't want to have a long, and it takes a long time to build something like this. And so I didn't want to have like quit A&M, then I'd be out of work for a long time, wouldn't have any money. So I had him building it in his garage because I was insecure about the continuity of, because I had a lot of clients and so forth. I was actually helping to make their whole studio complex profitable at A&M. I ran the mastering and then the studio, but because there was so much activity in mastering, and the studio never made money. So I thought, well, you know, this is a great opportunity for me to open my own studio, and this is a typical thing that you want to do when you're successful. So we were building the studio. My wife, it took 9 months just to build it out and all that stuff. And so I was going over there on the weekend doing tests and so forth to make sure the speakers were, everything was working. And so then I went to Herb. I sent in a letter of resignation to Herb. And he called me right over to his office. He says, oh, he says, you know, you're kind of one of the family. You know, because right after they went on that lot, I was working there. And he says, but I understand. He says, we did stuff like that too. I really had more of an affinity with Herb Alpert and A&M. I mean, I had done more work with them also. And that was in 68. And okay. So I told, Herb came in, and I was supposed to go, I told Elektra that I would take that job. But Herb came in, and I said, you know, Herb, I took the job at Elektra, but I'd prefer to work for A&M. The next day, his head of the studio called me and says, can you come over and talk to me for a while? I mean, I didn't want to talk to you about something. I knew what it was, because Herb said...
Picked you out. So then how long did you work at A&M?
15 years.
15 years. So that would have been what?
Until 84.
Okay, so 84.
That's when I opened my studio.
You remember the first record you cut?
Yeah, of course it was a contemporary record, because the stuff I was fooling around with at Audio Recorders in Phoenix was, I wasn't really anything, it was just the practicing. But the first album that I cut was, there was a, I think it was Good Time Jazz. I think it was it Tom Ewell, the piano player?
Don Ewell.
Yeah, it was a Don Ewell record.
Wow,
and
that's cool.
That was the first one I cut.
And is with that equipment right here?
Well, actually, it's exactly the same design, but it was on one chassis, the first amplifier. It was the first one that Howard had built. I was doing catalog work for Lester, mostly. I did do some recording sessions for him, though. But most of the time I was doing, to maintain the catalog. Art Pepper Meets the Rhythm Section was a popular album, so I have in my library at home the actual one that I cut. I mean, a pressing of it.
Really? Cool.
But that, of course, that was always very, one of the most impressive albums. You put that on and it was just there. I mean, you felt like you were right there. Sounds Unheard Of was amazing too. That's a pretty impressive disc.
Wow.
And yeah, that was pretty neat. It was a little noisy, tape hiss, if I recall. But that didn't matter so much. I'm not a stickler for tape noise.
Yeah, tape
noise
doesn't bother me.
You know, so what, yeah. But if the sound is really great, and that was good. And Sonny Rollins' Way Out West is that way. It's just like, it's just right there. You know, it's so good. But as the custom stuff came in, too, those Paul Winter Consort, that was very impressive stuff, too. There were things that were coming along all the time. Because in those days, a lot of recordings were made in a simple way. And in those days, the engineers, it was a higher priority for sound quality. It really was. Because nowadays, the newer engineers, they're just thinking about the mix and how it competes with other things and this and that. And they're not the number one, I don't get the sense that the number one priority, they're not audiophiles particularly. They're the number one, a lot of the producers and people that were working in the industry all through that period when I was starting out, they really thought all the time about quality, about what's going to hurt it. That's why it was really good for me, because in those days, you know, in the mid-60s, the way things were done, it was a different way things were done. In the major labels, a lot of stuff were done at major labels. Mastering was done there, the recordings were done there. If you were a Columbia artist, you worked there, you recorded there, you mastered there. And the thing is, the mastering engineer, the reason why they call him a mastering engineer is all he did was cut a master disc. He did nothing else. No adjustments, only level, All he was needed to know was how to cut a good disc mechanically and so forth, and so that it would track well. And they had parameters at Columbia. An LP of this length is this loud. If it's longer, then you have to lower the level. It's this loud. A 45 RPM was this loud, and that was it. And if you were a producer and you wanted to add top end to the second tune on your album, back in the studio, make a transfer from one tape to the other with the EQ, add the top end, put it in the assembly, give it to the master engineer so he could cut it flat. Okay, so at Contemporary, though, they had it set up to do all those adjustments that I was talking about. Level, they had equalization. I've been doing this because it was the old-fashioned vertical board. I'm doing this.
Yeah, the rack.
Yeah, the rack. So all of a sudden I started attracting all these people because I would adjust the sound on the fly from tune to tune. And so it was like, whoa, let's go over there. So I was fortunate. I was got running on the ground floor when mastering became a creative part. And so now, and it became more and more that, of course. Now it's a big creative part on a lot of recordings. It's questionable sometimes about the creativity took them in a certain direction that might not be musical or whatever it might be. But nevertheless, there's a lot of adjustment that's done in mastering now. And in those days, there was almost nothing done to recordings. I did some Doors records.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. I did a lot of electric work, too.
Wow.
Yeah. So because I would adjust it, and I would be more accommodating in that way, I think.
Yeah.
You know, I was willing to try all kinds of stuff.
From Contemporary, you went to A&M, and what's some of the records you remember?
Well, A&M... Well, you know, all those Sergio Mendez recordings. There was, and then we were doing custom work there too. You know, there were a lot of albums that were that came in that were from other labels and so forth. We did Carole King's Tapestry, things like that. That was one of the first really big blockbuster albums, I think.
Bernie, how closely aligned with the mastering and the artist performance were you? For instance, the Carpenters, did you do any of those at A&M?
I did all of them.
So I know Richard was very meticulous on his recording.
He was.
How did that translate into the mastering process?
Well, I mean, of course, mastering, you know, is kind of like a thing that kind of makes things a little more uniform. It's an overall thing, basically. It's creating kind of a spectrum balance that hopefully, we hope, is going to be one that works well on a majority of sound systems. So there was always some kind of adjustment on most anything that would come in. And, you know, I work with the artist usually or with the producer, and it's like, yeah, I have opinions, but the object in mastering is to make it more effective, to make it a recording that... hopefully we can get a better emotional connection of the music to the listener. You know, so there's less effort maybe in a sense. And that's kind of what I'm trying to be sensitive to. So hopefully if I'm doing it right, I'm actually helping the artist and the producer realize their dream. So in other words, I'm trying to get on their wavelength. I'm trying to make adjustments and things that actually give them more than what they thought they could ever get.
Was he working hand in hand with you on a lot of that?
Well, when the albums were done, yeah, he would come into the studio. Yeah, when they were done, they would come in. And every now and then, we usually had done some singles too off of this, the album. But yeah, they would, some of them didn't. Now, other people would just send the tapes over. I would do what I thought would work, and they'd listen to it and decide whether they like it. So A&M was still kind of built in a similar fashion to most record companies that had their own studios. They had also mastering. That was a typical thing to have both. And even Elektra that's why they wanted me to come work for them, because they were building they had built a studio, and they wanted to build a mastering room.
What year would you say, when did that like the labels stopped having their own cutting, you know, like seemed like it probably started around this. They probably all
a lot of them never stopped, you know, really? Because A&M had mastering rooms that were being used. I don't know. I think they up until fairly recently, actually, not that many years ago.
Oh, no kidding.
Well, yeah. See, Columbia just doesn't have studios anymore, so that's right. Everything's gone. But in New York, they had some cutting. But see, the cutting part had been really subordinated.
That's what.
But they have a master. They still have mastering rooms at Sony.
Yeah.
Vlad O'Miller is still there, I think, or he was. I mean, but they had a mastering room right at.
Well, their battery's pretty much there.
That's what they use now.
Yeah.
Yeah. So they might not have.
But
it
they
anymore.
Don't cut lacquers, but. But yeah, I think those companies started less. Like, but EMI or Blue Note or Capitol, I should call
they
it.
They have a mastering.
Yeah, they still have the lathe.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it seems like
it's smaller.
At the beginning, the smaller, like even at the beginning, A&M and Elektra
were small labels.
They
at the beginning.
The big independents, but they were...
Yeah. Right.
I mean, they both had big hits by the time this was going on.
A lot of big... They were pretty good size.
You know, Herb had a lot of hits in that era, in the early 60s.
Or do you know that at one point, Herb Alpert had 5 albums on the top 10 of the Tijuana Brass. 5 on the top 10 albums. You can't help but respect those musicians because they did such phenomenal things. And they were so creative. Yeah, I mean, even though you might be making pop records, there's a lot of closet beboppers.
Right, and then so in 84 you started your own master?
And then in 84.
So what was one of, do you remember the first job once you were independent?
One of the interesting things about that period is that was right, Thriller had come out, I think 2 years before that. Now, it's interesting how Thriller is a marker of that period for me, because I originally had a room upstairs where all the studios were, and then they built a whole section across the lot for mastering only. And I never liked a lot of the systems there, and I wouldn't go over there. And it was all around the lot that I wouldn't leave my room because I didn't think that the system was the way I wanted it yet. And that's when Thriller came along. And the first Thriller mastering was done in the old room at A&M. Okay, so after so many months or whatever, it was out on the market and all this stuff, I moved down there. Well, of course, Thriller was such a huge success. I cut about 125 sets of masters on that over a 2 or 3 year period.
Wow.
I cut in the original A&M room, in the facility that was built for mastering. I was cutting it there, and then when I opened up my own studio, I was cutting it there. Wow. So I kept cutting that album for years, but it had been cut in 3 different studios all, you know, through the years, and they just kept it. Just they sold so many records that they couldn't keep up with it.
How did you keep the recording level and the mix the same?
Did
you
have notes? The first discs were cut too hot, and cheap players wouldn't play them. And everybody was laughing about it, but I didn't feel that good about it because it wasn't. Some of them were skipping and carrying on and stuff because we really pushed it. And Bruce Woodin wanted it really power. And that was one of the first records that had a lot of bottom. You know, it was really punchy and a lot of bottom. That's hard to track. And the grooves were, and the computers weren't as good then. So we had to recut it at lower level. And now Bruce Woodin says, he'll bring out one of them and he'll say, this is one of the originals, the good ones.
Yeah, there you go. That's what I'm thinking. I need to go find those.
Yeah, but no.
Not really.
They aren't as good.
Yeah.
No, they're louder, but they're not as clean.
Yeah.
Because the louder a disc is cut, the worse it's going to be.
Yeah.
And that signal to noise is better, but it's not going to track as well because it gets radical.
So in 84, I mean, that's also the year CDs coming out.
Yeah, we had to, in fact, we were doing transfers. We didn't own the equipment at the time, but we were just buying it at A&M. We were looking at it and so forth, but what they would do is they would bring by, there were guys that were in that business to come by with the digital equipment and record, you know, you'd have the master and all that stuff all set up for disc, but then you just run it into the 1630s or 1610s, I think were the first ones.
The Sonys?
Yeah. Yeah, we'd run them into those, and then they would take
8-bit
systems. They would take them away and make CDs. And then, of course, later on, we were buying our own equipment and so forth. But, yeah, but CDs were coming in. They weren't so great at the beginning.
So in 1984, so one of the first jobs, I mean, it was Thriller, or you remember some another job?
Well, yeah, but what was I working on at the beginning? I mean, yeah, Thriller, I was always cutting Thriller, it seemed.
Yeah.
You know, it was like, it became a career. You know, I can't, like, you know, like, this is my kind of bread and butter thing, you know.
Right.
Every few weeks, somebody order another set of lacquers, you know, so, okay. Some of the first things, I'm just not sure what I was cutting, because, you know, Herb followed me right over to my own studio.
Oh, okay.
Even his stuff, he was doing in my studio. Even though he had his own mastering studio, he would come over to me all the time.
Wow.
I'll tell you a funny story about Roy DuNann, because we were talking about he goes square dancing on the weekends and stuff like that, and he lives up in Seattle, is where he lives. And you probably even read this article in Stereophile. But anyway, Stereophile magazine called me up because maybe you had recommended. You had told them, I probably know where he is. Nobody knew where he was. And they knew that he did these ridiculously good albums. So they wanted to interview him. So they called me and they said, do you know where Roy DuNann is? And I says, yeah, he's up in Seattle. I just visited him a year or two ago or whatever. You know, he lives on the outskirts of Seattle. And the guy says, God, I live in Seattle. The guy that was good at writing the article. Anyway, I told him all. I gave him his phone number and all that stuff. So anyway, he went over and he interviewed Roy DuNann. Okay, so here comes the magazine out. And I'm looking at Stereophile. I'm reading this article. And there's a picture of Roy DuNann, you know, they took a picture of him. So the article is going along and it says, and you were there. You did the Ornette Coleman album. And you were there, and what did you think? I mean, my God, you know, this was a historic album. You were there, and I said, what did you think of it? What did you think of it? And Roy says, I would have sent him home. That was his reply in the
yeah.
article.
Yeah.
That's Roy DuNann.
Yeah.
And you know what he used to do? When he didn't like something, he would write sarcastic comments on the tape box. So on Ornette's records, like, there would be a title of a song, I don't remember what, and it'd be crossed out, and he would have written Butchered Blues. Things like that. You know, he was a square dance guy. He didn't like jazz anyway, but Ornette, he really didn't like.
I can't.
The customers want to know how this stuff is made. They really care about these things. And nobody has shown them how it was made, where it was made, who's the people behind it. They want to know who Bernie Grundman is. They want to know what does his studio look like, what equipment does he use. They know it makes a difference. We want to show people the inside of a mastering facility, inside of a recording studio, you know, the different presses even, you know. What's a fine belt? People didn't know what a fine belt versus an SMT versus an Alpha Tulex. There's pros and cons on each one of them, and they all do different things differently, and they're better at certain things. But people want to know these brands. I think the reason that we do a good job or want to educate the consumer is because these are the things I want to know.
Well, see, that you're using yourself to figure out what people would be interested in. And I agree. I totally agree. Because the same thing was true way back now, because I go way back. But, you know, in the infancy of high fidelity sound or audiophile stuff, I got magazines and so forth. All those magazines, was a High Fidelity was there, and Stereo Review and all these. And I'd look at all these magazines. We never, as audiophiles, never saw behind the scenes that much. We might see a setup of microphones or inside a studio. It might show that. But they almost never, I had no idea what a cutting system looked like for years and years and years. They never showed, but when I finally did see one in a magazine, I was, you know, very impressed, you know. And so, I mean, just using myself as an audiophile, you're doing the same thing. You're saying, I know what people want to see. They're going to be fascinated by this.
Right, and I feel like, so how lucky am I or are you, you know, that you got to do what you're passionate about for a living. You know, tomorrow we're going to be listening to Way Out West, you know, the master tape. I mean, that's a dream of an audiophile. You know, you got to live your dream, and so did I. I mean, be able to make a living and listen directly to the master and looking at it and holding it. And we, you know, and I just know that, you know, I try to get done what they would like done and the way they want it.
You know, here's an interesting thing that's recently happened, is we're doing a lot of mastering for Thailand.
Really?
They're into this vinyl thing. Now, they're only pressing, what I think it's like 500 at a time. The main thing they want, though, it's like we're sending them, tests and stuff, but we're sending them digital tests so they can just hear the sound, and then we cut it onto the disc. But the main thing they want is my initial. That's what they want.
Yeah.
That's the main thing they want. Some of the stuff doesn't even sound that great, but they said that initial means a lot.
Oh, it does. It does, you know.
You know, so it's interesting how those things can influence people.
You didn't always put your initials, did you?
No, I didn't. Not, you know who had me start doing that?
I know.
Yeah, you know, Hobson.
Classic Records.
Yep. Yeah. And in fact, what he did was, I was cutting, you know, a lot of those recordings were done at 45 and never released. So anyway, the 33s were just the initial and the 45s were a signature. Hobson started all that. Because he knew what the audiophiles would be impressed with, I guess, you know. He's probably thinking about the future. He also knew the mentality and the things that interested audiophiles, because he's definitely, of course, an audiophile, just like I am. And he realized that would have some kind of cachet and some value, maybe not even right at that moment, but as time went on, and actually which would help me too.
Right.
And I mean, it just didn't dawn on me, but he was pretty good at what would impress people or what, because he was in business, you know, and
right.
He was wanted to market these things. So he wanted to build a brand, in a sense. So that's what he just asked me, he says, put your initial in there.
When you cut things for other people, are you putting them from now?
I do on everything, yeah. Now everything I put it on, yeah.
So
because now, sometimes if I don't, they get upset.
Right. Right.
And then they call my coordinator and say, did he really cut it?
Yeah.
It doesn't have his initial in it.
Yeah.
And I go, oh, well, okay. You know, I mean, great. I'm glad that it has some kind of pull, you know, or value.
Always trusted my ears, and I knew vinyl would never die. But what I didn't see happening was the CD dying like it did. I have to admit, I didn't know it would come back to what it is now. But I knew it would never die.
Yeah.
And it was always kind of growing.
It always had some...
like a little bit of...
Yeah.
And like, you know, a lot of mastering ears put their lathes away.
I know.
Yeah. And...
you know, we used to have a lathe in each mastering room. Because every... way back. Because that was like the reference. We'd make them a reference right there. You know, but now we have this dedicated room. And then it started growing.
Well, you know what I do now that we have our own pressing plant? Instead of making me a reference on something that may be usable, just keep it on the 14 and we'll plate it.
I have a client that sells, you know, licenses stuff, and he sells albums at the shows and all that stuff, at the audiophile shows and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
So he has me cut lacquers, reference lacquers,
yeah.
You know, to take to the show to play. And of course, everybody's like, oh my God,
right.
That's an incredible sounding. I mean, because they are pretty
they
amazing.
Are.
You know, the lacquers are dead silent, and they're right. I mean, it's
present.
It's very hard to hear the difference between the lacquer on a good cartridge and everything and the master. off the lacquer. It's really hard to hear the difference between the two.
Well,
on the outer cuts, anyway.
Well, yeah. what the way I see it is, now that I'm on plating, y'all usually do it as good as I want it anyway. If you send me the lacquer, it's so good, I don't like judging that. Since 9 out of 10 times the job was done right and good and acceptable, why don't I just plate it?
Yeah.
Because you and I will both save money in the long run. And I'm willing to take the chance of having you redo it, or me redoing it, because you got to redo it anyway.
And you'll know then exactly.
Right, exactly. You'll know exactly what you get.
Because it does change. Mm-hmm. And you never know exactly how it's going to change.
We're actually building almost like a custom system only for these recordings.
Wow.
It's a highly simplified signal path because, you know, again, less is more for quality. I mean, sometimes if you need a lot of manipulating of the sound, you know, if you need to manipulate it a lot, and some of these recordings that I get, you might have to, especially if they're very complicated recordings. So we have like 20 different ranges here or so of frequencies and so forth that we can push and pull and fool around. But the only problem with that is, if you do a lot of that, you're introducing more distortion. Now, our stuff is clean, but just like we were talking about earlier, every little bit does take away from the naturalness of it and the accuracy of it. So what we're doing in this is we're building almost like a similar system to what Contemporary had, because they only had 2 ranges of EQ available at any one time. So, and that's what this is going to be. This is going to be that kind of thing, but it's going to be another console here. You know, it's going to be going through there, and it's going to go in direct, and this is a tube, hybrid tube playback system for the tape machine that we use all the time anyway. It's got a solid state output to interface it with the board, but this is a whole, all tube front end and so forth from the tape machine. And this, but it's very quiet. It's got a great sound. It's very, really nice sound. So we're going to go right from that into this, and then right into the lathe. It even has a special shorter cables and so forth. And so the attempt is to preserve the quality of these recordings. So that's one of that's number one. And then the ability to do EQ, but very generalized EQ, which is all we did at Contemporary. That's all. And it also has send and return reverb. So we can do exactly what they did at Contemporary, add a little bit. And we have EMT plates in the back room, you know. We have 3 of them, of the old classic EMT plates that they did on all the Columbia albums, all those Paul Desmond things, Babe Brubeck, all that stuff. And Contemporary always put a little bit of that to just create a slight amount of ambience. But Lester was always very careful. He didn't want to draw any attention to it. It was like we would bring it up until we could hear it, and then we'd take it back.
Yeah, I remember that.
And then take it back so that it was more something more you just felt, but you couldn't identify it. But it just made it open a little bit.
Royal.
Because, you know, the more you put in of reverb, the less detailed and the less present it is. So he didn't want to lose that thing about the musicians are right there. So we just put a little bit of that in. So we're going to have that capability on this special thing that Benno's building up. We're pretty confident that it's going to be, it should do justice to these tapes. That's what the object is to really extract and try to give the public more than they ever have from these recordings.
Man, I'm getting excited, really. I mean, that's cool.
That's why it's taking us a little bit of time, because we actually have the head being rebuilt. Mm-hmm. He's building this whole thing up, this whole little console thing. So, we're almost there. Benno and I have been working on these things for a long time. And I've been living with cutting systems for all my 50 years. So we know cutting systems.
When things all come together and make sense, you know, I mean, this is your passion, where you started, John's life and his father's passion and life, records that all the audiophiles know and love. And we like to do these series, you know, and we like to take the pictures of the master tapes and doing the plating and the pressing and the listening, and then showing all the album covers, and then doing the tip-on jackets, the highest quality jacket you can make, money can buy. And then we want to do every detail from the artwork to the album jacket. To have you do it and John be involved and you be involved and then have the original system, and then it's like I just can't see how any one step could be any better than what's fixing to happen. We're lucky that everybody's still around, because a lot of times these labels, you don't know what happened. Yeah. The history's vanished. We're going to detail the list of equipment. Look, it talks about the West.
Recorded that, didn't
yeah, the Westrex 3C4545 amplifier, 200 watt Heyco. And look, this is all the technical. Not many labels did all this.
Yeah, as a kid, that's what I would read.
Right. Look, our lacquer master was compared to the original tape. I mean, it's all
documented.
Right, and not many labels did that. We want to do this.
No, that's important.
I have the one that Doug did. I have.
Well,
the one,
we need to know what he did. Yeah.
I have the one that Doug did. I have the one that John did.
I cut side two of this one.
Oh, did you? Oh.
This is the original.
Oh, really?
And I just love, I mean, of all the labels in the world, there's the Stereo Records label.
Oh, the Stereo Record. I remember that, yeah.
I mean, it's just the colors. I mean, it gets you, I don't know. I mean, I'm almost embarrassed to admit how excited those colors and the way it looks.
Yeah. You know? I remember that label, yeah.
And the font. Everything about it. And this is also a deep groove record. We can make deep groove. When they say the blue note deep groove,
yeah, like
that's what they're talking about. And so
yeah, those are all done at RCA, weren't they?
Yeah,
the Hollywood,
the Hollywood plant. Yeah.
So we have Way Out West, the original one in the middle that John did, and Doug Sachs, plus we have these two different gold CDs. Mm-hmm. To compare, plus the master tape.
That's
so, yeah.
That should be.
Yeah, it's a little bit.
I can get an idea of, yeah.
Well, we definitely have to listen to the original. That half speed, you know, the sibilance is harder to control, right? If you're cutting half speed.
Well, yeah, it's hard to say. I'm not sure. I've never really done half-speed mastering, but one of the biggest problems should be in the bottom end.
Yeah.
Because the bottom end needs to be some pretty healthy equalization, because now 30 cycles is 15, and tape machines and cutting systems don't like something that low. They don't respond well down there, so you have to make them respond. So you have to build in equalization, a lot of extra equalization in the signal path, in a sense. It's in the signal path. And that, you know, takes a toll, because what it does is it'll make it less clear, less defined. And yeah, that's what I've noticed about the half speed ones. They're muddy. He's got it pretty well lined up. That was just a standard test tape. So
we did have the pre-emphasized high.
Well, yeah. Now that
unusual.
Now that's, we have to decide. That's one thing we'll have to decide on, how to do that. Right now we can just do it by ear, and see where we end up, because it should be theoretically too bright when you play it on a standard test with a standard alignment.
Do you want to explain, is that something interesting to explain that won't...
I don't know whether... I'm not sure whether... Well, it's kind of interesting. It's kind of interesting that Roy thought of that as a very simple way of trying to get rid of some of tape hiss. You know, just trying to make it quieter. Because it's always been something that tape had, was a amount of tape hiss, you know, ambient noise.
Especially in the days of this tape. This is Reeves Soundcraft, which is essentially Scotch 111.
Yeah.
Which had larger oxide particles.
Right.
And
but that's why it stays...
They were noisier, but yeah, the high end stayed better.
It stayed because bigger particles, they don't erase themselves. Smaller particle ones that go out further, you know, have a wider range frequency response, tend to lose more of the transients and high end because all those little particles are actually kind of working against each other in some ways.
Explain how Roy DuNann recorded this differently than most people record.
In a very simple way, because the machines have two equalization systems. They have one for 15 IPS, one for 7.5. And what he did was he switched the equalization to 7.5, which is a steeper curve. And he recorded it, in a sense, pre-emphasized with more high end than is normal on the normal curve for 15 IPS. He had it jumped up another 6 dB so that when he played it back, when that went back down to zero, it brought down the tape hiss.
See, he
at the same time.
Re-referenced the machine on playback to bring down the top end, and he brought down the hiss with it. So we put too much top on the tape. If you played it flat, you bring it down, you also bring down the hiss.
Same way with discs. The RIAA curve, that's what it does to quiet down the vinyl. They pre-emphasize the high end on the cutting system. And then when you play it back on the RIAA curve, because it's on the pressing now with the boosted high end, now when you bring down the high end, the noise of the vinyl goes down.
But what about the part where the adding the EMT, the reverb, I mean...
Oh, that's different.
That's after that. That's the next,
that's
little
the
farther
next,
down
that's,
the line.
That's in the chain. That's just been...
I know, but not everybody did, you know, recorded that way to add...
My father's theory was to record as clean as possible, and then if you're going to manipulate, you have the option of doing it later. Whereas if you put reverb on it at the live stage, you're stuck with what you got, even if you got it wrong.
But we did it directly from the three track. We had all three we had three channels going, and we also added the EMT and everything to get, but we could duplicate that EMT sound, the sound that Columbia had, because we have the plates right in the back room.
So yeah, the timeout is awesome, and we sell the 45, and it sells, and it's
but that had, that was all kind of this system with our EMT and everything.
Did kind of blue, did you...
same thing.
Did you go from the original...
Three-track.
Three-track straight to lacquer?
Right.
So, I mean, the classic kind of blue is three-track straight to lacquer with an EMT added?
Yep.
So, when y'all recorded, he just decided, instead of putting the EMT, the reverb, into the original recording.
Yeah.
Like he might have put too much or not enough. He could always change
control
it later.
Yeah.
And not many people did it that way. And so now...
Well, no, I think people did. Yeah. I think
in general,
no,
in that
in general
era,
they did. Even like on those three tracks, they didn't put all that reverb in there. Because
yeah,
then they didn't want to get locked in.
Yeah, you're in the heat of battle when you're recording a live session. You have enough to worry about without having to worry about do you have the EQ right?
Yeah.
I mean the reverb right.
Yeah, yeah, because that's tricky. Reverb is a touchy thing.
Yeah, some of the Prestige, some of the Rudy Van Gelder, I think on certain artists like Gene Ammons and that.
Oh yeah, you put a lot of reverb.
Yeah. And
well,
I think
he's that kind of player. It was that kind of mood.
Yeah.
You know, it was an interesting thing, though. I saw an interview with Van Gelder where he said, you know, when he did records for Alfred Lion, he had to do you know, exactly what Alfred wanted. And so he never experimented. He always did what was tried and true and excellent. And sometimes he either, when he was doing prestigious, he kind of cut corners, or he tried new things that Alfred Lyon wouldn't have tolerated. And so the quality of the prestigious is, you know, from a recording standpoint, is a little bit less even, whereas the Blue Notes are all pretty much the same.
Right, but some of the, what I heard he said, or what I've heard been said, is the difference between Blue Note and prestige is like 2 days of rehearsal or something.
Where, well, yeah, Joe, oh, yeah, Henderson, well, prestige. Joe they Henderson just, told me, you know.
They were like, they, I think they, didn't they book the studio every Friday?
Something like
they had, well, yeah, every
think,
Friday.
And I think that that Alfred Lyon did the same thing. But the thing was with Alfred Lyon, and Joe Henderson told me this, that they would always pay musicians to come and rehearse. And that's why those records sound much more spontaneous, because yeah, the guys aren't struggling with complicated charts. They already have them sort of in their DNA from having gone through them once. They go in, boom, hit it. The first take is usually the best take anyway, because it's the most spontaneous. When you're struggling over the music, you know, it's not going to sound as good. It's just going to be...
Is that the right side too?
Yeah.
This is the disc. This is the tape. This is the disc.
Well, you've got more top end rolled off, that's all.
Collectors are really excited to get an original Way Out West, but they ought to be putting it on their wall, not playing it. They ought to be playing what's kind of come out of here. if they really want to hear something close to the tape.
Now we can cut that right now on here.
Okay. Yeah.
So now it's almost just in this.
Should be even better when we get this thing.
So you were flipping between the cutting that was actually being made.
Yeah, actually, right after it was made. Yeah, so
wow.
Because it's one half revolution away.